Express crew, whose name starts with man. So if you think you're a fan, and you're down with the clan, get up everybody, and clap those hands. Now, but I'll run into you later. And when it comes to beats, there's no one greater. Original and swift, as you rock, of course, fader. So with that, I think, and you will know why. And we don't really plan to go by without letting you get a reminiscent MCT and Mantronik just rocking like this. Listen up close to what I'm talking about. Is what it's all about. Devising, surprising, so sweetly mesmerizing, reaching great heights and steadily climbing. Up, forward, as great as can be. To the sense, always help our celebrity. So with that, I'm still persist to line you like a fish. With faith, not late, just considering this to be our main matrimony. Rocking one and only, and the ceremony for the time of cold Tony. A woman that's given, the person that's driven, the speed of my body on the corner still.
Okay, so that first song you heard was Baseline. And Baseline, as I can remember, was definitely 1985. And it was like the third song we heard from Mantronik. Now, the first song, of course, was Fresh as the Word, which I covered in part one. Then we had Needle to the Groove. All these are 1985. And then the next thing we heard was Baseline. And I can distinctly remember Baseline being a big deal because as simple as the Baseline was, I remember I was able to play it myself, just a couple of notes. But it was the first time we saw the group going into a more musical direction with their sound. What I mean is, Fresh as the Word was just a drum machine and Mantronik on the wheels and MCT. And then Needle to the Groove, the follow-up, you know, they didn't really change the formula up much. You had, again, MCT, Mantronik on the wheels. You had a little vocoder in there for the hook, and that was different. But basically the same formula. And for Baseline, you know, it's not like they put a lot of music in it, but the fact that they did have that keyboard Baseline, it was a little different. You know, first video we saw from the group, you know, they were starting to, you know, kind of get big at that point. And I think it was a very wise decision to make it a little more musical. But they did a very good job of balancing, making it musical and maybe a little more danceable, maybe, but still keeping satisfying the street element. And the elements that were fans of definitely Fresh as the Word and Needle to the Groove. And by the time Baseline came out, you know, the album was out, and the album was actually called Mantronik the Album, because we had two singles before, and then we had a full-length album with, like, you know, maybe eight songs on it at the time. So like I said, nothing incredibly groundbreaking as far as the production yet, only adding in the music. But you can see the direction that they were going, as far as the success that they had off of Baseline. You could tell, you know, whether it was the label or whether it was themselves saying, okay, we need to continue doing this, or just them maybe, or Mantronik himself maybe maturing musically, whichever one it was. You could tell that direction, they were continuing that direction after the success of Baseline. You know, during this time, you know, definitely in the 80s, before the sampling era came, I would say from, like, you know, the first handful of rap records up to maybe 85 86, I remember hearing John Roby, and he's part of the production team along with Arthur Baker that gave you Planet Rock, you know, produced the music to Planet Rock and Looking for the Perfect Beat, Renegades of Funk. And I remember seeing a video of him, and he was talking about the mixing board and effects. And he was saying how effects at that time were like an instrument in themselves. So you use the board like an instrument. And, you know, as far as the effects on the board, the echo, the delay, the reverb, and all the different effects you had on the board. And one thing I really liked about Baseline, you know, it was a little more polished in that way. You know, you could hear what they were doing with the hand claps, especially if you listen to the intro, when you got just the actual keyboard intro going with the Baseline. And then you start to hear the hand claps come in. You can hear the delay and the echo on the hand claps. Very effective effect that they used on that recording. And for those that really are listeners, you can also hear it on the other instruments too. I love the snare on there. You know, I love the drums. Just sonically, Bassline was a dope record. Now, the next song after Bassline was actually Hardcore Hip Hop. Now, Hardcore Hip Hop was a very complicated record. You know, again, for those that listen, you can hear a lot of things going on. You hear like a lot of those stabs that I talked about, like it sounds like a horn hit maybe that's sampled, but sampled in a rhythmic way, and most likely on, you know, triggered from some kind of keyboard or whatever, because it's like playing in tune. So you hear dent, you know, it's not just dent, you know, it's not just dent. The original sound was probably that, but it's the way that it was manipulated through, had to be through some kind of keys. It was played like dent. And again, this is something that was really embryonic in the sound of Mantronik, because Mantronik and his production, because in the next few Mantronik songs and definitely the next couple albums, you would hear him manipulating those little horn stabs a whole lot more and a lot more rhythmically. But that's one thing that stood out a lot about Hardcore Hip Hop, and the way he was cutting the that Fab Five Freddy changed the beat. You know, and again, you go back to part one of the Mantronik lesson that I did. I talk about how he cut that on Fresh as a Word, and he also cut it on Needle to the Groove. But the way he's doing it on Hardcore Hip Hop is just really unique. The way he's doing, like, and it goes really good with the beat. And then the way he's got the beat, it's almost like he got two different drum beats and you know, different drum sounds. And that's why I would love to talk to him, because it's almost like, did he have two different drum machines going? Because he's got a drum pattern going, and then another drum pattern comes in, and boom, bap, boom, boom, bap. That's one whole drum pattern. It almost sounded like a loop. I doubt very seriously in 85 it was a loop. But, you know, that was one drum pattern. Then he had the main drum pattern. So all this is being manipulated and brought in and out. And I love that about the production on the record. Something else that I really liked about Hardcore Hip Hop, and this is something that MCT did, it was a very big deal to me at the time. Because, you know, the way rap years move, you know, it's almost like dog years, especially in that first decade of recorded rap music. You know, a sound or era would be replaced very quickly. You know, when I was doing more written pieces for my website, The Foundation, I did a piece where I talked about the different schools, and I called the original school, I think I called it the first school or the original school, and then I called the next era the middle school, and then I called the next one the new school. And what it was, like, from 79 to 82 was the original school of recorded rap, and it mostly contained a lot of the groups that were actually, you know, pioneers before there were rap records. And it was that, you know, the Cold Crush and Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, Spoonie G, Funky 4+1, they dominated in that 79 to 82 era. Soul Sonic Force and those groups, you know, Jazzy Five, you know, the Zulu groups. And then from like 83 to 86, I called it the middle school. And it's funny to say middle, because, you know, if it's a middle, it must be an end. And then I called like what they dubbed the golden era, I call that like 87 or 88 through like maybe 90, no later than 91. Now, those schools, they ran, and this is my little theory, these are my writings, you know, nobody told me this. This is what I observed just from being an avid fan and consumer of rap records. This is what I observed, that rap changed drastically every 3 years. And those schools I just named, they run parallel with what I talked about on a recent lesson. It may have been the Larry Smith lesson, and I may have mentioned it on the Mantronik lesson. But what I call the band era, where, you know, labels like Sugar Hill and Enjoy and Paul Winley Records and those first handful of labels, Sound of New York, they had bands recreating the breakbeats that were played before rap records came out. So they were trying to emulate something that was going on in the streets. That was the band era. And then you had the drum machine era, which was Run DMC's entry, and that was 83 till about 86. And then when sampling became affordable technology, and then the Ultimate Breaks and Beats series came out, that's what gave you the golden era. And I also have a lesson on that. It's called Why the Golden Era Was Golden. And it's a very good lesson, and it's coming up maybe in the next two or three that I do. But what I'm getting at is I didn't name anything after the that last era of the Golden Era because nothing new stylistically really came up after that. Now, rhyme-wise and style-wise, definitely, MCs was taking it elsewhere, where, you know, the De La Souls and the Native Tongues and all them cats was crazy with it. But after that era, nothing really new enough came as far as production and the original style of using records, whether it was, you know, going all the way back to the bands recreating the records, up to people sampling the records, mimicking what was done before the rap records. You know, after a while, you know, production became, you know, keyboards and things that were not record-based, which, you know, rap music had always been, basically. So I didn't name anything after that last golden era because nothing production-wise, to me, really came out enough for me to really name it anything or you know, put anything to it. So I say all that to say, by the time 85 came, it was very... you were almost, if you were still talking about cats like Spoonie G and Grandmaster Flash and Melly Mel by 85, a lot of cats was looking at you kind of funny because, you know, Run DMC was definitely the thing, and, you know, LL, you know, had made his first couple records. And, you know, both Grandmaster Flash as a group and Grandmaster Melly Mel in his Furious Five made good records in 84 and 85. You know, Step Off and B Street Breakdown, Pump Me Up, they were really good records. But, you know, it was like the last part of Sugar Hill Records, and so, you know, those were like the last standouts that was really still holding the torch for that original school. But if you were still talking about the Treacherous Three and cats like that, you where I was, you were getting clowned. I remember getting clowned for still talking about cats like that. So what I'm getting at is MCT said a verse on Hardcore Hip Hop, his last verse, and it was like a dedication to that original school. And not a lot of people did that. You know, cats at that time, they didn't look back. You know, once the torch was handed off, people didn't look back to what was, you know, what was gave them that torch to even pass. You didn't hear MCs shouting out cats on records. You would, if you looked at the liner notes, you would see Special Thanks, and you would see people thanking those pioneering groups, but they weren't saying it in rhymes. So MCT said a rhyme that I thought was really a big deal in 85, and I thought that was, you know, mighty big of him because he didn't have to do it. But he shouted out, like, you know, a lot of the those original pioneering groups, and I thought that was a really good verse. So yeah, you knew that T, or I knew at the time, that T really knew his stuff, because he didn't just say the Funky Four MCs. He said the Funky Four MCs with Chi-Rock on the side. You know, he got very specific. He even named the Crash Crew. Like I said, groups that it was, you know, not necessarily fashionable to still be talking about those groups in 85, which is, like I said, time really moves fast with this culture, or with these rap records. I won't say with the culture, with the recordings, times were really moving fast because those guys were still on the top of the world as far as recordings, like 82. By 82, you know, they were still, you know, very, very much on top. And then 3 years later, you know, it was just not cool to mention those cats in a lot of circles. So moving on.
Now collaborating with the king of the beast, Tito Rock and Mantronik will now defeat you.
So I do find it necessary to give you a little bit of background on Tila Rock, you know, but real quick, just a quick side note, on the first Mantronik lesson that I did, Kurtis Mantronik, or whoever runs his social media, actually shared it. And that was a real big deal to me, you know, for me to do something on somebody that I grew up to or grew up on. And I didn't interview him first. I'm just strictly going off of my memory of these, this music and how it affected me, you know, that long ago. And for him to see it, or whoever officially runs his social media to see it and post it, that really meant everything. So I was looking at the comments from when he shared it, and one person said, this is really good stuff, but the guy who narrates talks too much. And that's not, it's not like I didn't know that, you know, I talk a lot. But I will say this, and I really feel the need to say it. Anybody who's watched my lessons, I really am a stickler for details, and it's almost impossible for me to talk about certain things without connecting them to certain other things. And I say all that to say, like, I'm about to talk about the record we just heard, Back to Burn by Tila Rock. But that wasn't his first release on Fresh Records. And I, you know, again, a lot of us who know a lot about rap music, we just assume that everybody else knows what we know. But there's an awful lot of people. I get people who are like, oh, I'm 19 and I wanted to know the history. You know, that's a lot of people, even younger than that, in the comments who are learning. So I feel the need to really, really connect the dots. And I'm just that guy anyway who, you know, my whole thing is I want to know the story behind the story behind the story. So that's what I give you, is all that. So, you know, you're going to have a lot to digest when you're listening to my lesson. So those, if I'm a little bit too wordy for you, you might have to fast forward or whatever you need to do. But, you know, it's almost impossible not to be wordy at sometimes. So Back to Burn was the first collaboration with Tila Rock and Mantronik. And Tila Rock was not new at all to the game. Tila Rock, of course, is the artist on It's Yours. It's Yours, of course, kicked in the doors sonically, lyrically, for a lot of things. First Def Jam, you know, production. It really wasn't Def Jam Records yet, but it was Def Jam / Party Time Streetwise. Rick Rubin really put the bass up really loud on that one. Tila Rock tells me that Rick Rubin was, when he was in the process of trying to make rap records, you know, Rick Rubin was a DJ originally, DJ Double R. And he was looking for the people who made Planet Rock. He liked that drum machine. And that's why when you look at some of the first Def Jam records, and I have a lesson also about the first, those six or so Maroon Def Jam records, I have a lesson about those. And I'll go more in depth then. But, you know, you'll see Afrika Bambaataa's name on the, and Jazzy J's name on the back of It's Yours, which is what made me buy It's Yours. I'd never heard it, but looking at the back, I was just I saw the curve arm turntable on the jacket. I had to buy it because I was like, who would make a record cover with a curve arm turntable on it? And on the back, it had a Scratch Party Def Mix. And anything with scratching on it, I was buying it back then. And they thanked Bambaataa and Jazzy J, so it's got to be a good record. And I brought it home, and it literally changed my life as a person and as an MC. So anyway, that was the record that made cats that were lyrical and trying to be MCs, or that were MCs, go get the sources. That record influenced LL. If you go back and look at my LL lesson, I'm still talking about It's Yours. That LL lesson that I did called LL the MC, he was heavily influenced by It's Yours, and even styled his first record, I Need a Beat, in some ways, you know, after some of the subject matter and just the pattern of what Tila Rock had done on Def Jam, but, you know, not even a year before him. So that was 84, I believe, was It's Yours. Then in 85, Tila Rock is on Fresh Records, and he does a collaboration, a EP of sorts, with his brother Special K. What's up, K? From the Treacherous Three. an incredible MC and a great producer in his own right. And they produced together an EP called He's Incredible. And, it, you know, it's not really an EP. It's really like an extended single. It had three songs, Breakdown, He's Incredible, and Tila Rock, Rockin' the Party. But this was a very important record. You know, it didn't chart or anything back then. You weren't hearing it on the radio, you know, maybe late night mix shows. But a very important, lyrically, very important, you know, a continuation of what was done on Is Yours. Very, very good drum machine programming by Special K and Tila Rock. Very bare bones and stripped down. It reminds me of the stuff we used to do, you know, in my house practicing, you know, when we first started. Just, it was just a drum machine and us and scratching. You know, it's almost, it didn't sound like a demo quality-wise, but it was very bare bones. You know, you could tell, and that's the beauty of those first rap recordings, some of them, the early ones, there wasn't somebody in the studio saying, oh, you need to put some keyboards in there, put this in. This was very stripped down, just drum machine, raw scratches with some effects on them, and the MC going for his. So that was the He's Incredible maxi single. Another relevant point of that was, again, you know, not knowing what Tila Rock looked like, those of us who weren't in New York or the tri-states or whatever, this was our first glimpse. You know, they had a picture cover, and you even had Louie Lou on the back, so that was refreshing. And then that brought you to 1986 and the first collaboration with Mantronik as a producer with Tila Rock, and that was what I just played, Back to Burn. Now, again, when I tell you about those little horn stabs, you know, again, this, you know, continuing, Mantronik is continuing this. You know, the first couple records I started out with were 85 from the Mantronik's album, and this is a year later, and he's, you know, again, dent, 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 you know, in a rhythmic way, he's manipulating those stabs, and that was dope. The way he did the hand claps on the song, that always caught me, because I was, you know, again, just, I'm a listener, you know, and I'm listening for every nuance in the beat with Mantronik and his productions. And the way he did the hand clap, and I think a lot of that was the programming mixed with the effects and the echo on it. Again, you know, Mantronik could make a snare roll, you know. A lot of people in my comments on the first Mantronik, they give him props as being the godfather of trap music. And, you know, whether I can't disagree with that. If you know, I'm not necessarily saying that these young producers heard Mantronik and mimicked him. Some of them did. You know, I failed to mention Manny Fresh on the first, and he's not trap. I'm not saying that was more that New Orleans bounce music. And a lot of that music was inspired by the drag rap by the Showboys, which was actually a New York record, but there was a breakdown in it that kind of gave birth to that that New Orleans bounce style. Anyway, Manny Fresh, I did not mention him, but Manny Fresh, along with, I've heard Timbaland give props to Mantronik, but Manny Fresh, I've heard many times, one of the few, you know, cats from this era or modern era who always talked about Mantronik, and I did put Manny Fresh's picture up on that lesson, but I failed to mention him by name. And then a lot of that bounce stuff, to me, it graduated to what they call trap. But that style on trap, you know, they're still using a lot of 808, and they, you know, the hi-hats are like machine gun. Their program with machine gun rapidness and the snares, the way they make the snares roll. Whether they are knowingly doing what Mantronik did 30 years ago or not, more than 30 years ago or not, they are doing what he did. So I will say that whether directly or indirectly, Mantronik, Kurtis Mantronik, is the godfather, or at least inspiration to the cats that did the trap stuff. But on the first part, on part one, I talked about the Tricky T record, Johnny the Fox, and how he made the drums, you know, the snare. You know, he's a beat programmer. You know, he didn't mess around with that drum machine. He wasn't playing. And if you listen to Back to Burn, there's a lot of drum rolls on there. It's a well done record, and again, a lot going on. Another interesting part of this song, two parts, all within the same area of the song. Tila Rock said a rhyme where he said, Lynn drum, DMX, and drum you later, all combined to create fresh data. I don't know if he's saying that those drum machines were necessarily all used on this song, or he's just saying these are some of the tools in our toolbox. And he's told me before, I've had several conversations with Tila Rock over the years, that he's somebody that I talked to recently, probably, once a week, him and his brother Special K. And there's just so much information that I don't remember what drum machine was used on what. But just interesting that he would divulge that information. A lot of cats won't tell you that kind of stuff. You know, when I talked to Duke Booty, who was a very hot, and this is Ed Fletcher, co-writer of The Message and also the CEO and founder of Beauty and the Beat Records, that did the King Cut record with DJ Cheese and the Z3MC's record, you know, Hard to the Body, and then all those different records. But those records all had very, very heavy, heavy drum sounds. And I remember asking him, what was he using? And, he never really answers. You know how it is when you're talking to somebody and they don't really want to tell you, and they don't say, I'm not telling you, but they end up not telling you. A lot of them cats, they're very guarded with stuff like that. But T put that in the rhyme. And in that same part of the rhyme, you heard the great Greg Nice, and that is Greg Nice from Nice and Smooth. He started, you know, as a beatbox for Tila Rock. And, you know, you look at Tila Rock's old promotional pictures, his old, you know, what you call a press picture at the time, you'll see Greg Nice on them. And, you know, Greg Nice was on other records too, but he was actually on Back to Burn. And I thought that was a good part of the song. Yeah, so that's the great Greg Nice on the beatbox. He was nice with that beatbox, the human beatbox, definitely. I spoke on part one about that energy or synergy when you got a cat doing a human beatbox over top of the drum machine. It's just a certain energy it gives the record. I love to hear that combination. If you want to know what I'm talking about, you can go back and listen to a song called A Cosmic Blast by Captain Rock. And there was a version of it called The Pure. P-U-R-E, The Pure. And on the Pure, I forgot the name of the beatbox. Captain Rock told me, but it slips my mind at this point. But the cat that's beatboxing on The Pure, when you combine that with the drum machine and the scratching that's going, I think that was Daryl D. Scratching Daryl D. Man, you know, that was a great era, that the human beatbox era alone. But when they started to combine it with the drum machine, that's a great sound. Now on Back to Burn, if you go back and you listen to the instrumental, I spoke again on part one about those edits. Shep Nunez on the edits on this one, just crazy. The edits were crazy. And again, these cats were splicing tape. This wasn't anything done digitally with any kind of Pro Tools and any of the conveniences that we have today. This was done with slicing tape, you know, reel-to-reel tape with a razor blade, and editing in that way, the old school way. And those edits were incredible. And like I said before, I'll say it again, do yourself a favor. If you can get your hands on the original versions of these 12 inches, you know, the original version is always a good version. But if you listen to the dub version and the instrumental versions, they just go off with the edits. Incredible stuff.
It's a love story, y'all, and it's serious. You know, I don't know better. Cause all I wanted, you know, was a relation that's immune to thoughts on floor. But there was one thing that I did ignore. It's like a bash or a bagel to cut and leap to dangle. I can't do it all alone. It takes two to tangle. I'm willing to attempt and even just try. Please don't walk away and say goodbye. It pushed me way, way down like a great big star. To want to love so close, but you were so far. To even daydream or even fantasize, I must face reality and come to realize the way I feel is a one-sided affair. Even though you deny, I don't think that you care.
Mantronik did some excellent work for Just Ice. Whew. That love story, that was just such a dope record. If you listen to the drums, listen to the kick drum, it's definitely layered. You know, if you listen really closely, if you listen to it on big speakers, you might not hear it because that bass is really, really deep. But if you listen to it on headphones, you could tell that there's more than one kick drum, more than one bass drum. When I say layered, he's put different drums on top of each other to make the drum, to fatten the drum. I mean, it's a very common practice, but he did it to great effect on there. The snare on there is popping, and those little bongo sounds, the way he boom boom doom, boom 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 boom, that was just a dope record. And you know, for them to take that, they could have went any kind of way with it. It didn't have to be a love song, but to make it a love song and not put any music in it, you know, make it a hard love song. You know, that's Just Ice. You know, he's not going to be rhyming over anything, you know, with any keyboards and all that on a love song. That was a great record. Just Ice was saying some stuff in that, but that damn beat, just the combination of that layered kick drum, the snare is hitting hard. And again, man, trying it the way he makes those snares roll, and the repetitiveness that he does when he programmed those, and just throwing that bongo in there was just, that's a crazy beat. And again, you didn't hear this on the radio. I mean, you know, Just Ice just wasn't the guy played on the radio anyway. And I'm talking about, you know, prime time radio, you know. And this was like 1986 on his Back to the Old School album. You know, he got played on the radio, Kiss and BLS, you know, New York, you know, radio, which was definitely different. But this is this is what was considered the underground at that time. You know, just great. And then of course Turbocharged was the second one that I played. Yeah, I always had a problem with the vocal being so low on that. And when I interviewed Just Ice years ago, if you go to my website, foundationhiphop.com, if you go there and click on interviews and just search through them, it's a couple pages of interviews. At the bottom is a next button. You can just keep hitting next until you see the Just Ice interview. I don't think it's on the first page, but either way, it's a written interview I did with Just Ice. And first of all, he said that's one of his favorite songs by him. I think he might have said it was his favorite. He said he still listens to it, he loves it, but the thing he hated about it was that his vocals were too low in the mix, and they were too low. One thing, that kick drum is really heavy. That drowns him out. But even if it didn't have that kick drum, that heavy kick drum, it's just his vocals were too low. That song wasn't mixed well. I would love to see a remastered version of the whole album, really, but I would love to hear that song as it should have been done with his vocals more up front, because Just is rhyming his ass off on the song, and just the energy of the beat. You know, I told you before, look out for the bells. You know, I still haven't even gotten to that, but you know, he was sprinkling, Mantronik was sprinkling his bells in the tracks, and again, I always want the energy and the synergy of his tracks. The bells give his tracks this energy, and damn, he killed that beat. He killed the bells on that. I had some people, I hadn't even talked about Turbocharged yet, but people in the comments of the first Mantronik lesson that I did were talking about Turbocharged, and that's my favorite workout song. And it's funny because I used to work out the Turbocharged. There's the energy in it. It's just, that's, and I used to ride around to that, you know, when I had a car with a system in it and I was in there riding around with my music loud, I would just pump, you know, you pump Turbocharged with a frown face, you know, that's the energy that Turbocharged had.
Get.
Okay, that first joint was Ladies. And that was a really big record for the group. I think it did really big on the club scene. Again, this was from the Mantronik's The Album. I remember that record really blew up, really big on the club scene. It was all kind of remixes to it, and UK remixes. A lot of the stuff on this label, on the Fresh Sleeping Bag label, a lot of the Mantronik and a lot of the Tila Rock stuff, you would see like these special UK mixes. And I think those records were really big in the clubs in the UK. But I spoke in part one about, I didn't like how it came out. I didn't think I explained it really clearly. Sometimes you can respect what goes into a record, but it's not your favorite song. And that's how it was with Ladies at that time. When I listen to Ladies now, I can appreciate it a lot more. But I was like probably 15 years old when that record came out. And at that time, I wanted everything to be just drums and MCs. You know, once we got spoiled with those, you know, Run DMC records like Daryl and Joe and Hollis Crew and Sucker MCs and everybody else that was doing that in that era, I wanted everything to be drums. And for me, honestly, at 15 years old, Ladies was too musical for me. You know, bass line I could take, you know, because it was just the bass line and the scratching and the drums. On this one, it was, you know, a lot more music than anything we had heard yet up to that point from Mantronik. It was a little too musical for me at the time, but now when I listen to it, again, this, what he does with those hand claps on those beats is incredible. And at this point, he's showing his range, too. You know, the fact that you can make Fresh as a Word and make Ladies says a lot. But again, I was too young to respect that at the time. I wanted what I wanted, and I wanted drums and rhymes. But you can hear that the actual bass line on that one is a little more, you know, a little more complicated. Still not a very complicated bass line, but a little more complicated than the song bass line that's from that same album. And you know, you got some other keyboard sounds in there as well. But Ladies has aged. That song has aged well. You know, I listen to it a lot more now than I did at the time. Now with Get Stupid Fresh, you know, we've almost covered the whole first Mantronik album. Again, back then an album was like four songs on side A of a record and four songs on side B. You know, you didn't have these albums like now where you got, you know, 15 songs and six skits and all of that. You know, it was just four songs. The last song I played was Get Stupid Fresh. It was basically an instrumental with MCT, you know, speaking a little bit in it. It was a dope beat. Again, the drum sounds that Mantronik used were always dope, but I honestly always felt that was filler. You know, a lot of albums, they would, you know, throw an instrumental on there just as filler, and I always felt that song was filler, as good as it was. But I will be very honest, the only reason I put Get Stupid Fresh on is because there was a part two to Get Stupid Fresh on another album, and that was a phenomenal record that I listened to today, and I still just sit and try to dissect that record, and it's just... is a crazy record. So I only put part one on this to compare and contrast to part two, which blows one out of the water. The only thing they share is the title. You know, it's nothing like that that second one.
Oh yeah. Right about now. Kicking it live on the bass machine, better known as the beats, we call them Mantronik, and I am Tila Rock. Now throw your hands in the air and wave them like you just don't care. And if you like the sounds we're throwing down, somebody say, oh yeah, oh yeah. Oh, yeah. The music that you hear penetrating your ear, it's perfectly created to alleviate fear. For those who are weary of adjusting to rap, I have a premonition you will soon adapt. See the music being played by a musical whiz. The sound you receive will come from his innovative mind, which I'm sure you will find uniquely educated and well refined. He's a beat specialist, a master on effects. Originality is what he projects. Song like rhythms on top of the beat differentiate my record from the ones on the streets. The name Mantronik, now world renowned as the king of the beats, the master of sound.
wounded.
My voice permanently is now disclosed. My disciple colonnaded since the day I rose. I'm audible in speech, not hard to discern. I'll edit mistakes to relieve your concern. Discharge your negativity and listen good. Have you ever heard rhymes so clear and understood? No is the answer, you must reply. I'll invest your loyalty so it will never decline. As though you diabolical, malevolent ducks who continue to imitate and won't give up. It should be understood that if I could give you a whole lifetime, you'll never write this good.
Man, there's an awful lot going on in that record. That's Bass Machine, and that's Mantronik on production. Man, again, listening to what he does with those snares, how he just makes them roll. And man, you know, in the record you got a lot of Greg Nice beatboxing, a lot of, again, you know, not to beat a dead horse, but the manipulation of those horn sounds, or you know, those stabs. He's, you know, again, you know, I keep pointing that out, and I'm trying to do that in sort of a chronological fashion, because you know, it continues through as Mantronik and his productions mature. You know, you see that more and more, and you can see it building now. But Bass Machine was just a different kind of beat. You know, again, the hand clap. It's a busy record. You know, you got the, you know, what they call a clap track or crowd track in the background, you know, where they just take one track and, you know, they put the party. People sound like they're having a party. You know, that was very much a staple with Sugar Hill Records. That's one thing Sylvia used to do. She would have a, what they call a clap track, where people would just be on there. Yeah, ho, ho, you know, and a lot of that on Bass Machine. And it added a certain dynamic to it, because the beat was already energetic. And the fact that they had the clap or party track on there the way they did, it definitely gave the record that added energy. And it already had energy anyway. Incredible Greg Nice work on that, the beatboxing, but damn, Omar Santana on the edits on there. You know, the way he's rocking those edits is just incredible. Incredible recording. Bass Machine's a unique record. And Bass Machine was the flip side of Breaking Bells. And if you looked at the retraction I put out about part one, Tila Rock took issue with the fact that record was credited, this is Breaking Bells, to Mantronik. He said that Mantronik was there for pre-production, and he, you know, he did some stuff on the pre-production, but he wasn't even in the studio for like an hour or so, you know, less than an hour. And that, you know, whatever he did on pre-production, Tila Rock and Louie Lou went back and redid Breaking Bells. So Tila Rock said that there's no Mantronik contribution on Breaking Bells. But the flip side, Bass Machine, he said he did produce that. He did produce Back to Burn, which we listened to previously. Now, by 1986, only a year after their debut album and their debut singles and everything, the group Mantronik and MCT, they released an album called Music Madness. And Music Madness was, it was such a, like a graduation from the minimal sound of the album, Mantronik's the album, their debut album. But where I was talking about ladies being a little too musical for me, they were able to take a perfect balance of keeping the essence of the drums and the programming that Mantronik did on the first album, adding some musical elements to it, but making it so dope. You know, it wasn't like the, what I said about ladies. You know, it wasn't too keyboardish. Very electronic. He, at this point, he's messing with a lot of electronic sounds and bleeps and blurps, and his drum programming is, he's graduated. I mentioned in the first lesson how, you know, he would throw pieces of samples in, no loops, but just pieces of samples. And, you know, now he's still not looping, but he's throwing in a little bit more. I don't know. Music Madness was an incredible record. Like I said, it was a great maturing of sound for the group. And again, such a maturing that didn't happen over like 3 years. They didn't take a hiatus and come back 3 or 4 years later. They came right back the next year, and it sounded like Mantronik had been in the lab, you know, honing his craft for years. Very strong sophomore effort.
We have to teach you not a preacher. You'll never be beneath us. Again, you're not a man, and I swear I'll meet you.
Okay, the first song was We Control the Dice, and that so many Mantronik favorites that I have, but that's up there. It's in my top three, and I never do load those top lists and my top whatever, you know, with MCs and groups or whatever. But of these songs by the group Mantronik, I have to say that's one of my favorite probably songs by Mantronik, maybe number two. But some days it might be number one. But We Control the Dice, again, when I talked about bells, he's got a bell in there. He's got a whistle. Again, he's killing that snare the way he's making that snare roll. His drum sounds are popping just right. Incredibly hard kick drum. And the bass line in it is basically the same bass line from the song bass line from the last album. He just recycled it. You know, he added a little something to it. He put a couple little extra notes in there, but it's just the same bass line. But damn, did he kill it. MCT was in top form, you know, move to the rhythm, proceed to the beat, because it's a necessary force like the food that I eat. Duplicate the hands of fate and take a bite of the blind. MCs, oh Christ, they swear they're nice, but they forget when I project, I control the dice. That's one that I still listen to, and I you gotta listen loud. Some joints you just gotta, you know, these songs were made to be played at very high volumes, and you got to play We Control the Dice at loud volumes. That's just an incredible record. And I spoke about Get Stupid Fresh Part 1 from the first album, and like I said, it was, you know, it was a cool beat and everything. You know, nothing fancy to me. You just, of course, it was a Mantronik beat, so it was good. But when you compare it to part two, which he called Listen to the Bass of Get Stupid Fresh, first of all, he's got a Brothers Johnson sample he threw in there. That was a very popular break. I mean, in fact, it was a very popular Brothers Johnson song, Ain't We Funkin' Now. But that was the 12-inch disco edit, which was actually a breakbeat back in the days. I know Flash used to cut that one up a lot. You know, most of the DJs would use that. But the part that goes, listen to the bass, he's got that slowed down considerably. And he called this one, Listen to the Bass of Get Stupid Fresh Part 2. And if you listen to the bass, that kick drum in there, that bass is not playing. And that harmonica sample was by Area Code 615, and it's a song called Stone Fox Chase. And just, you know, I throw that in to show you the brilliance of Mantronik to take that. And I think that was from like a TV program or movie. That was a very familiar tune. I believe it was from an old TV program. But either way, to take that and flip it the way he did and put that incredible. If you listen to that beat, I was talking about the bass on it. He's got at least three different kick drums on the beat to Get Stupid Fresh, or Listen to the Bass of Get Stupid Fresh Part 2. That track, man, is one that I play it a lot. Again, I play that one loud, you know, in the car. Just, again, you got a meme mug to that one, because that's a hell of a beat. Then he's also got Sing Sing by Gaz in there, which, again, that's another break beat. Everybody has used Sing Sing, and I don't have time to really play that one. You can YouTube it or go look for it if you're not familiar with it. But yeah, Mantronik showed his ass on that beat. It's a lot of layers to that beat, and again, sonically, that's just shit is incredible.
Stupid. Now I know you never heard.
Now, the first song was Music Madness, which is the title track from the LP. A lot going on there. Of course, you got the Herbie Hancock Headhunter break, God Made Me Funky. Classic breakbeat 101. Nice usage of it there. Nice usage of it. And once again, at least three different kick drums that I detect in that song. Some bells low in the background, just a piece of some bells in the background. And the way he programmed the beat is just very unorthodox. It's almost hard to put into words. If you hear it, you hear it. It's hard to translate into words. It's not offbeat, but it's just an awkward drum pattern. And it's brilliant. It's genius. And everything about that song, it was mind blowing from the first listen. And what I've realized is I'm gonna have to do a part three. I've never done a part three on an artist, and I've never done two parts that were more than an hour. Maybe on Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, because they had such a discography, and the group broke up, and it was a lot of songs on both sides after they split. But outside of that, just a solo person, I didn't even do two parts on Marley Marl, even though I definitely could have. But with Mantronik, it's not just like I'm playing a song and then saying, oh, this was this, and moving on. It's so much to his beats, and it's so much, so many layers. But, you know, on this one, again, on Music Man, he's throwing the stabs in. He's not really manipulating them and making them very musical. He's just, But it's done to great effect, and it's an incredible song. I mean, it's really hard for me to translate that into layman terms of what he did to make that beat. and make that track, but it's just it's outstanding work. The Electronic Energy Of is the second song, and first those lyrics will be recycled later for another song off their next album, if the album in full effect. But Electronic Energy Of is just an incredible song. I mean, I talked in the first part about how futuristic Mantronik will become. You know, he started out futuristic even when he was doing the most minimalist and simplistic things. Even his logo, it was computerized. The font of it was computerized, and the sounds became more computerized. And even, I used to always love the voice on the Electronic Energy Of. The hook part, it says, the Electronic Energy Of, it sounds like a robot. And the way he's throwing the break in, you know, that's another break that, you know, you'll have to guess that. It's a lot of breaks. In this album, he's doing a lot more sampling, and that's going to carry over into the next album in full effect. And, you know, on part one, I did criticize MCT for, you know, just poor enunciation on some songs. And you have to really struggle to make out what he's saying at times. On this one, he was saying some really dope stuff, and I hate the fact I can't quote it like I want to, because I can't make out every word. But just, even on his intro, he says something about, I'm mostly understated, but mostly comprimanded with a radical style that exceeds what was planned. It was dope. His cadence was dope, how he came in. He just didn't enunciate to bring it over strong. And that's, again, you know, not to tear him up or anything, but that's the only negative on MCT, was that this is really hard to make out what he's saying at some points. And in another part later in the song, he was like, I be the great narrator. He was top shelf on here. And if his enunciation had been better, he would have took it across the line, across the finish line on it. But either way, a great collaboration and a great song. Yeah, that's Big Band B-Boy, one of my favorites by him. Not a lot of people talk about that song. In fact, I never really hear anybody discuss it, even fans of Mantronik, but that's one of my favorites. On that one, he sampled, he got his own drums on there, but that little shuffling beat you hear is a group called the Charlie Colalo Orchestra, and it's a song called Sing, Sing, Sing. It's an odd song from like 79. It's halfway disco, halfway like techno, electro. It's an odd song, but he used that for that little shuffling drum beat. Then he of course put his own drum beats on. He used some other like 80s records, and you know, it's again layers in that one. But the way he brought it all together, you know, it just made an instrumental, you know, big, it sounded like a big band track, you know, big band B-boy. He converted, you know, previously used things, you know, and samples, and put his own stuff in it. And again, genius. So I'll have to do a part three to get into in full effect. He did a song called King of the Beats, which is very, very, very important to sampling and 90s sampling. And some really big hits came off of the King of the Beats. It was like an instrumental cut and paste track he did that was just incredible. And it really cements his, for me, it cements his position as just being a damn genius. In part three, I'll also get to his Hanson and Davis stuff and No Sarah, Summertime, and stuff he did for Joy Sims. Part three should be pretty good and a lot shorter than these previous two. Like I said, I'll run through In Full Effect, which was an excellent album. And then the rest of those productions that I talked about, they're almost like alternative to what, you know, to what he was used to doing, or I would say what he's known for. They weren't hip hop. They were like freestyle tracks. But again, they do show his range and show the range of talent and abilities that he had. And that he still has. If you go to YouTube and check for, look for Kurtis Mantronik on YouTube, Kurtis with a K. And the stuff he does today, it sounds like what a cat that was doing this kind of stuff in the 80s and 90s, it sounds like what they would be doing today, you know, 30 years after the 90s, you know. So he sounds like he's right where he's supposed to be. He's not trying to sound like trap. He's not trying to sound like he did in the 80s and, you know, and resurrect or, you know, or be stuck in that style. He's progressed, and he sounds like what you would think that Mantronik, or what I would think that Mantronik should sound like 30 years later. And it's almost like everything else is finally caught up to him. Like he was already in the 2000s, you know, and everything is just catching up. And that's foundation lesson number 30, Kurtis Mantronik, King of the Beats, part 2. Hope you found it enjoyable, entertaining, educational, and enlightening. You can reach me on all social media at Jayquan VA, JayquanVA. If you have the need to send me an email for any question or correspondence, it's Jayquan@thefoundation, THA foundation, FOUNDATION.com, Jayquan@thefoundation.com. Peace.